16 May 2021. While waiting for my ramen to heat up, I, like any self-respecting adult, was digging around in the mud looking for bugs, and I discovered a red-eyed nymph. This insect likely had not seen sunlight for 17 years. I poked it with a stalk of dried grass. It was a member of the Brood 10 cicadas, returning at last. Don't worry, I made sure the nymph was safely covered up afterwards. When I checked on it later to make sure it was okay, I found the nymph's butt sticking out of its hole as though it had pulled the covers over its head like, I don't want to get up yet. May 21st. Cicada shells appeared on tree trunks, walls, stalks of grass. I found an adult cicada. It began. The red eyes and orange legs marked it unmistakably as belonging to one of the three species of Brood 10 Pharaoh cicadas. On 22 May, I could lightly hear the cicada's distinctive love song. I found a cicada with deformed wings clinging to a clover blossom, its shell beneath it. I also poked it with a stick. Although its wings were injured, the cicada's healthy sexual appetite animated its climb up a tree. Earth is home to thousands of cicada species and three hominin species. Because of their tube-like mouths, cicadas are considered true bugs. Entomologists refer to any cicada species that live in the same place and emerge from the earth at the same time as a brood. North America used to be home to 23 broods. Today, only 15 remain. The three species of Brood 10 follow a peculiar life cycle. As in all cycles, there's no end or beginning, but a continuous process. We have to start somewhere, though, so let's start with the cicada's mating. Using an organ called the ovipositor, the female cicada slices holes into tree branches and lays its fertilized eggs. The eggs hatch 4 to 6 weeks later. The nymphs fall to the earth and bury themselves, spending the next 17 years underground, where they grow and sustain their life functions by sucking on tree roots. In 17 years, if climactic conditions are good, the cicadas emerge from the soil, climb onto the highest surface available, and shed their brown shells. The initially white adult waits around for its wings to dry and its pigmentation to come in. Then it starts climbing. Cicadas prefer their orgies in the treetops. Once up there, the male cicada vibrates an organ called the timbal to attract females to mate with it. This accounts for cicadas' distinctive songs. This cicada got stuck coming out of its shell.
There's so many questions yet to answer about how they live and what they're doing and how they interact with other organisms.
Even when I didn't find cicadas, I encountered other interesting animals. Oh, look at its bright orange pollen sacs. Usually earthworms only surface after rain. This one must have been a bit confused. May 25th, the cicada's song was picking up. I found numerous cicadas with injured wings. When they're unable to let their wings hang down after molting, deformation can occur. This is probably why these cicadas remained near the ground. Lucky for them, I was around to set them somewhere nice. There was also no shortage of healthy specimens. For us, a lawn is just something to step across briefly. For cicadas, it is a vast and perilous forest. A wolf spider lives in that hole. A cicada is a great meal for a spider. May 28th. I went to a certain woods expecting a swarm of cicadas. There were almost none. Where were all my bug friends? Was the trip in vain? While it might seem hard to believe with the billions of cicadas that emerged, Brood 10 has been declining for decades, like basically all life on Earth. The IUCN Red List currently considers the Faro cicada near threatened. The culprits are climate change and habitat loss. I spent a lot of time in this forest as a kid, but the suburban sprawl had increasingly encroached on the woods over the years. Pesticide runoff can't have helped either. The river used to be full of crayfish that had since vanished too. Hundreds of tentworms and woolly bears used to reliably appear all over my hometown every spring and summer. Now there are none.
Oh my goodness, he's weaving. Hooray!
30 May. The swarming ants seem to bother this cicada. I imagine it would be a bit like walking on marbles. Marbles that could eat you. On cooler days, the cicadas were less active. As ectotherms, they require direct heat to have the energy for their wild sex parties. May 31st, I went to another park to look for cicadas. Oh, pardon. I found such a heap of shells and corpses that the stench of rot filled the air.
This is just a magical moment. And it's also a little heartbreaking to watch all the cicadas that don't quite emerge successfully, even though they've been waiting for 17 years.
This beautiful individual had only recently emerged from its shell. This cicada decided to climb my windshield.
I always really liked them. I found them to be very fascinating creatures. They look crazy, and I just think it's so cool to see them leave their exoskeleton and turn albino and then change color. So I remember playing with them a lot when I was younger.
The evening of that strange day, I experienced the most magical cicada encounter I would be privileged to enjoy during the whole 17-year bonanza. While on a walk, I noticed a cicada nymph crawling on the concrete. The adults were on every tree, most walls, and occasionally on people. But I rarely notice nymphs anywhere. Their legs pinch one's skin as they move across it in a way the adults' legs do not. This makes sense since the nymphs need tougher, hooked front limbs to dig through the earth. I kept seeing nymphs around. Then I heard a sound like pattering raindrops. What was it? Then I realized. It was hundreds of tiny cicada legs climbing over the leaf litter under a patch of ivy, the nymphs ascending to molt. Seeing so many soft white insects entering the last phase of their lives all in one place was extraordinary, suspended from their younger selves' shells with wings spread like upside-down angels. I stopped my walk to stare at them and stayed until after sunset. Unfortunately, the darkness precluded recording good footage on my smartphone camera, or even snapping good photos. This was my best attempt at photographing a cicada mid-molt. This unlucky individual seemed to be terminally injured. Life is hard for a cicada. In the same patch of ivy I'd marveled at the evening before, I found an unlucky cicada who was still stuck in its shell. By accident, I exacerbated its predicament. This is why my strong desire to pick up insects might not be the best. This individual died before it could even molt. Cicadas would often chirp. Sometimes it almost seemed they would end up in a sticky situation and call out for help, even though they certainly lacked the faculties to help each other. It's almost like they want predators' attention. Sisyphus. Third June. I returned to the first park that had been so quiet, and now I could hear the cicadas there, too. There were still not as many as I'd expect in a forest. This exhibitionist couple decided to mate outside the privacy of a tree branch. How naughty.
And it's clear that the governor doesn't think enough is being done in the city to curb the violence and save lives.
Some cicadas suffered from the pathogen Massospora cicadina.
Massospora cicadina.
A fungus that follows the cicada life cycles. Remember the zombie fungus from The Last of Us? Massospora is a similar, though unrelated, species. The insects remain in the soil for 17 years, and Massospora spores spend all that same time in the soil too, waiting for emerging nymphs to brush against them on their way to the sunlight. The fungus grows inside the cicada, destroying their organs and causing their rear ends to fall off, genitals and all. That white chalk-looking material is the fungus. Using the chemical cathinone, which is similar to amphetamine, the Massospora boosts the cicada's already high sex drive so that the clueless insect will spread the spores. The cicada's body's literally falling apart in a mad zombie orgy, the insects don't seem to notice. The species of Massospora that infects annual cicadas contains psilocybin, so presumably someone could get high off them, though I advise against trying. June 5th. The cicadas had reached their peak. The cicadas' undulating drone, thousands or millions of individuals shaking their timbals in harmony, a sound the human voice cannot produce and the human hand cannot spell, could be almost hypnotic. For those who never experienced this, let me be absolutely clear that you can hear this sound indoors, in your car, everywhere. The cicada's song can exceed 90 decibels, comparable in loudness to a leaf blower or lawnmower. But Earth's loudest insect isn't Magicicada, but the African species Brevisana brevis. While loud sounds normally agitate my misophonic soul, for some reason the cicada's sound never bothered me. People tend to call it screaming, but the cicadas don't just go, "Ah!" There's a harmony to it. Driving down the road, I felt a flutter of excitement at the abundance of life, watching dozens of cicada shadows flying over the street and among the branches of every tree. Some days would alternate between sun and gloom. When the temperature went up and the sun rubbed us with its beam beard, the cicadas erupted into activity. June 8th. Sometimes cicadas could end up in inconvenient places. This one decided to hang out in the bottom of the trash can. My arms were too short to scoop it out. Instead, I enticed it onto a piece of wood and was able to close the trash can. The bin has since become infested with maggots instead. Returning to my car in the evening, I found two cicadas having sex on my window. I reacted somewhat differently than I would if I found two humans in a similar position. One of the cicadas appeared to be suspended upside down by the penis. Some insects are elegant or give an impression of intelligence. Cicadas, in contrast, are so dopey it seems incredible that any of them survive. The casualties of Brood 10 were many. The average sidewalk would be littered with wings and other severed body parts, as brutal as the grisliest battlefield. A certain irresponsible man introduced European lizards to my area. The first time I saw one interact with a cicada, it poked the insect and took off running. Later, however, I saw a lizard with its face in a cicada's abdomen, eating the insides like some people eat a lobster tail.
Oh, nom nom.
I would anthropomorphize and suggest that the lizards figured out the cicadas were edible, but I don't know whether these lizards are intelligent enough. The species has been here for decades now, so they must have already encountered Brood 10, but I doubt the lizards can do much in terms of passing down info to younger generations.
Hum, nom, 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 nom.
Juicy cicadas are a tempting treat for birds, spiders, ants, dogs, cats, squirrels, basically anything with a non-sucking type mouth.
Hum, nom, nom.
The ants couldn't seem to fit this cicada into their tunnel. For some reason, this spider seemed to ignore the cicada beside it. The Brood 10 species strategy is just having a whole bunch of cicadas around, enough billions that the predators will eat them and keep eating them until they're so full they can't eat anymore, allowing the remaining cicadas to carry on the species. Humans also eat cicadas, though usually the nymphs rather than the adults.
I think now my fascination has turned into more of a culinary thing. Like, I like to see how they taste and how you can prepare them.
I mean, actually, so the caramel popcorn I have, they're covered in caramel, and these caramel chocolate-covered cicadas would be perfect in ice cream.
In 2011, an ice cream parlor in Missouri called Sparky's apparently sold a special ice cream made from cicadas, butter, and sugar. The ice cream sold out rapidly, but officials told them to stop. This year, an ice cream parlor at Princeton made their own cicada ice cream. In this one, the cicadas were apparently powdered and mixed into chocolate chips. It also sold out rapidly. I've never tried one, but supposedly cicadas have a nutty flavor. I imagine it would be like eating shrimp. Among the Haudenosaunee, the cicada is regarded as a delicacy. The story goes that in 1778, Joseph Brant, a Mohawk chief, rejected the Haudenosaunee Confederacy's agreement to remain neutral in the American War of Independence. Brant and his bands began driving colonial invaders out of their territory. In retaliation, George Washington ordered that all the nations of the Haudenosaunee were to be destroyed, their towns leveled and crops ruined. The resultant Sullivan campaign earned Washington the title of Town Destroyer. Though the Haudenosaunee people survived, they lost their homes, food, and most of their possessions.
You can just imagine the disruption that of what our ancestors had to go through, and to still be here, for us to still be here. It's amazing.
But in 1780, the cicadas happened to emerge, and with their singing, called attention to this alternative food source. The nation continued eating cicadas ever since.
It doesn't have a bitter taste or anything to it. Need salt and butter.
The 1780 cicadas were part of Brood 7, not Brood 10, but it's still an interesting story.
But the wings are hard to swallow.
Hey buddy, do you know that you're messing up people's cars?
95 degrees outside, and I'm putting on a jacket. I don't want nothing to touch me. Y'all walking slow, and then walking slow, taking your time. All these flying monkeys out here, and ain't nobody scared.
You all right? What happened?
I was driving, and guessing it was a cicada flew in, and just smacked me right in the face.
Yeah.
And when that happened, like...
Thank you. In this year, 2021, don't we have enough problems, Jessica?
Well, I mean, this is the solution. This is not the problem. This is the solution to having a bad year, is that there's these periodical cicadas that are coming out to bring us some enthusiasm, to bring us some pep to our day. We have these brutes.
Says the bug person. Says the bug person. This is be a nice time for the bug people and the cicadas.
It's okay.
I was going to say, if this is a gift, I really don't want to know what you get people for Christmas. Just like, go ahead and take me off the list.
They're friendly creatures.
How long was it in the soil?
They're all in the soil for 17 years.
Dracula!
I noticed that this small tree teemed with the chirps of cicadas. To humans, a tiny, I think, oak means little, but for the cicadas, it is space enough for a block party. The branches were sufficiently low that many protruded beneath chest height. Stepping into the tree was like entering an alien world, all on an ordinary street. Cicadas live on tree sap. They don't do serious damage to most trees, though saplings might not be able to withstand the onslaught. Some people covered their plants in protective nets. Cicadas' excretion, similar to urine, is basically just sugar water. I know cicadas mistook me for a tree, but I was still surprised to feel one pinching me and discover that it was trying to drink sap from me, too. Why the mouth can pierce tree bark but not my skin, I do not know. June. Cicadas were in steep decline, but their remnants proved that they were there. Plenty still remained. I was disappointed there weren't more active. Often they would begin flying and walking the moment I stopped filming. I don't blame them for feeling camera shy. Thank you. Cicadas react differently when you pick them up. Some don't seem to respond at all, but others, like this one, would begin loudly chirping, as though thinking they could scare me off. In Phaedrus, Plato wrote that when the Muses were born and music entered the world, people sang so full of joy that they forgot to eat or sleep. When they died, these humans became the Muses' favorite animal, the cicada, who need no food and drink, but sing their whole lives, watching humans to report back to the Muses on how mortals honor the arts. Plato must not have known about the years the bugs spend in the dirt, but of course, Plato, too, was referring to a different cicada brood. He was in Greece. Artists from many cultures and time periods have taken inspiration from the cicada's life cycle and singing. They spend their lives in the dark underground, only to grow wings and fly free just in time to fuck and die. A lot like humans when you think about it. I bet these cicadas regret wasting their youth sucking on tree roots. While most people seem to, let's say, not appreciate these insects, the emergence of billions of magicicadas is an extraordinary natural event unique to these parts of North America, like people elsewhere have aurora borealis or butterfly migrations. Their numbers had already dwindled, but this was the last day I remember seeing this many cicadas abuzz with activity. Pun intended. By 1st July, there were almost none left. Their songs had vanished from the trees. I wish I'd noted the last day I saw a live one. I plucked it off a flower to show my niece. After death, over the course of hours, the magicicada's eyes fade to black. But the same day I noticed the cicadas declining, I spotted the first fireflies of the year. In the weeks since, instead of cicadas, I found hornets and moths and June bugs fluttering around the grass. Unfortunately, I didn't record footage of these insects, so I'll depend on somebody else's footage of June bugs. In the trees, today I can hear the dog day cicadas. They are black and green instead of black and red. While they emerge from the soil every year, I've never actually seen one, or never actually seen one alive, since they're smaller in number and better at hiding. My only regret is that I didn't visit more forests to be among the cicadas. I heard stories of people walking outdoors and suddenly having 10 cicadas land on them. I wanted that to happen to me. I wanted to feel their tiny legs on my skin. YouTube recommended me this video of a guy with moths on his face. I want that to be me, except with cicadas and more than three. There are a number of parks in my area I could have visited to see whole canopies alive with fluttering, horny cicadas, but busy with my quotidian nonsense, I chose not to. As a result, I missed an incredible opportunity I'll never experience for another 17 years. What I treasure most about the brood 10 cicadas is the sense they gave of being surrounded with life, and not passive life like plants and fungi or meek millipedes, but active, soaring life, beings that, facing sunlight and death simultaneously, go out exploding with noise and sexual vigor. Even in my sterile but cluttered room, I could always hear the cicada's song booming through my windows. I apprehended then awe for the sacredness of life, the sort of concept I ordinarily abstractly understand but do not feel. But noticing the insects that are still around me, I realized that maybe the cicadas just drew my attention to the abundance of life that was already there. 26 August. That day I finished the recording for this video. Many trees displayed a symptom called flagging. Sometimes the incisions the female cicadas make with their ovipositors interfere with the tree's circulation enough that the stem downstream from the eggs withers. These dead sticks with their browning leaves eventually fall off. When the eggs hatch, this allows the babies to easily reach the soil where they'll spend most of their lives. Lawnmowers are a grave threat to the cicada eggs inside fallen stems. Cicada cut mark scarred almost every branch of the small tree I inspected on 11 June, but only two limbs suffered any flagging. When they hatch inside healthy branches, the baby cicadas just fall a long way to the ground instead. A tough start to life. Of course, killing trees is never in the cicada's interest, so they have evolved not to. A tree is bonded to the cicadas like a mother, a given generation's food source, home, and incubation chamber. Likely it will remain in that role as long as the tree, and cicadas, last. Every adult of Brood 10 is dead, for the time being, but the next generation is already alive. The nymphs are sucking tree roots beneath my feet, and perhaps beneath yours. We'll see whether I'm in a place where I can meet them, or even if I'm still alive for these insects' next emergence 17 years from now. My main concern is how much longer our world will be able to sustain these creatures, and these other insects that I've noticed around me, but still in number so much smaller than when I was a kid. Those of us blessed to be among them should appreciate the opportunity while it lasts.